Good morning and welcome to you online and to those of you who are here. I know for sure we're expecting others to come, but welcome to those of you who are here to our service of informal Holy Communion this morning on a very beautiful but very crisp morning at St. Mary Magdalene in Addiscombe, East Croydon. And if you're worshipping with us from home now or later in a recorded service, we know that we are united by the power of the Spirit. Let's just have a little prayer together and then we're going to sing our first song. Lord Jesus, thank you that you are here with us. Thank you that you lift our hearts in worship of you. We pray now you would send your Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with your love so we can worship you with all our heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Big welcome this morning to our band. We've got Av and we've got Val back with us. And Katie's come to join us to help lead on the piano. So let's stand and sing together. Jesus, be the centre.
Do be seated. A good morning to you all from me, Val, and welcome to those of you online watching today or later in the week. It's a crisp, bright morning, but it's lovely sunshine. Now today I'm going to be different and I'm going to use the passage and the material that the children are using in their roots. So this is set for the children for today, so it'll give them an introduction to what they'll be hearing later. But what they see and hear today is not what they'll be learning in their groups. And it's from Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 to 23, when Jesus begins his ministry and calls his disciples. So early in Jesus' ministry, after his baptism, he heard that his cousin John had been arrested. And this made him more determined to preach the good news of the kingdom of heaven. He started to tell people to repent. And in this passage, it was not saying sorry or about the confession of doing wrong, but about a change of mind, purpose and direction so that you can look towards God. When we repent, we are choosing to go on an adventure with God. I wonder how God might be calling you children to change and be more adventurous with him in school, with your family, or home. Well, the disciples responded to Jesus immediately. Jesus makes his way through Galilee, teaching, proclaiming the good news of God's kingdom, and healing the sick. Now, I'm going to show you an example of change. So I've got a glass bowl here of water, and we're going to see what happens when the pebble drops in. You can imagine a pond, and when you throw in pebbles or rocks, stones into the sea, and how it ripples away. So we're going to see if it works. You see a little bit, but now I want you to look carefully, and I'm going to drop some food colouring in. So you can see this change going on with the water, the change of colour. I'll hold it up a bit. If I swirled it round, you'd see it more, but it's beginning to go orange. And that's the transformation of something happening. So now we have a picture on the screen. Now, you can have a look on the screen. There's a picture coming up of a steering wheel. Now, if you're at home, you can imagine a steering wheel. Just think of a car steering wheel. And you might want to think about what happens when the wheel is turned in one direction and then it's turned the other way, what might happen. But it's really important to turn the wheel the right way when we're driving along. In today's story, Simon Peter, Andrew, James son of Zebedee, and his brother John left their boats and nets and changed their direction and followed Jesus. They were fishing on the shore with a big net when Jesus called out to them. Jesus wanted them to leave their jobs as fishermen and follow him. Jesus wanted to teach them what he was doing so that they could go off and do the same thing. They would be reaching out to people and asking them to follow Jesus and serve and help people just like Jesus did. I wonder how Simon Peter, Andrew, James and John were feeling as they started their new adventure with Jesus. Do you think they might be worried or would they be excited? I wonder how Zebedee was feeling as he saw his sons leave him and their boat behind. Would he be sad or would he be pleased for them? Children, think about whether you want to steer away from or towards something so that you can follow Jesus more closely. You can share his love by loving others. Jesus wants us to tell everyone about him and to invite them to follow him. This is an incredible blessing and an opportunity that we have from God. We could still do the usual things we do in our lives, or there may be things we can leave behind so that we can follow Jesus enthusiastically. But we can also spread the love of Jesus and ask other people to be part of God's family. We need to be willing to follow Jesus and to encourage others as well. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for calling us to follow you. Help us to turn away from things that get in the way. Give us your eyes to see you and help us always to follow your lead. Amen.
Val, can we just have the water back a minute?
Yeah.
Would you really like to see this water change a different colour? Have come on up then. No, can we use your...
Yeah.
Do you want to come on up and see the water change colour? Because where we're sitting, it just looks transparent.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Come on up. It's orange, it's not blood.
It's orange. Orange juice from a Chris Dingle service many years ago.
Oh. Whoa, that stinks.
It's actually out of date now, but it doesn't matter.
So we've just put a little bit more in. You can try this at home. Have you ever used food colouring for anything? No, it's very exciting. You can change the colour of cakes and so on. So I think we need to stir it, don't we? So I'm going to use my finger.
Yeah, I should have brought something with me.
Yeah, there we go. Orange water. And it just, there's a lot of water in there compared to how much orange there is in here, isn't there? So it's just a little drop in there changes and makes a difference. And do you remember Val threw the pebble in? Let's wait for it to go nice and still. Okay, that's fairly still, isn't it? So something comes in and it affects the water. And it affects the water. I have got a microphone on, but maybe I'm on mute. But
that's okay. I don't know what that is.
There weren't any ripples there, but anyhow. There we go. Anyway, you can go and sit. You're going to go to your groups now. So if you'd like to go through to the back, we'll pray for you as you go. So if you children would like to go through to your groups at the back with Belinda, it's the sun. The sun is wonderful. It kind of blinds you to seeing what else is going on in the church. Lord, we thank you for our children, and we thank you, Lord, for your love. And we pray for them as they go to think about you more and about the disciples following you, Simon, Andrew, James, and John. We pray for your blessing on them. Amen. We're going to continue in prayer as we come to God to say sorry to him. He forgives us for all our sins. And he leads us in his ways because he loves us. We just take a moment to be still and quiet. To bring to him the things that have actually hurt us, which in turn can cause us to be angry. Bring to him the things that we know we've said, know that we've thought, know that we've done that are wrong. Let's pray together. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us. And restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, thank you that you forgive us our sins, that you cleanse us completely, and you pour out your love into our hearts to make us new. We thank you for your forgiveness, your restoration, and your new life. Amen. Amen. We're going to have two readings this morning, and then I'm just going to talk mainly about one of them. And I know, Ryan, you're going to be reading, and I think you're reading 1 Corinthians. Is that right? Yes. So if you'd like to come up and read that. And I think, David, I sort of snavelled you as you came in to read John afterwards. So, Ryan, could you come up to this microphone here and read us the passage from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 10 to 18? Thank you very much.
This reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 10 to 18. A church divided over leaders. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers and sisters, some from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this. One of you says, I follow Paul. Another, I follow Apollos. Another, I follow Cephas. Still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so no one can say that you were baptized in my name. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanus. Beyond that, I don't remember if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power.
Thank you very much, Ryan. And would you like to come, David, and read to us from John chapter 1, verse 29 onwards? Thanks a lot.
This reading is taken from John chapter 1, verse 29 to 42. The Lamb of God. The next day he saw Jesus coming towards him and declared, Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me of God, who takes away sin from the world. Sorry. After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was here before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John testified, I saw the Spirit descending on him like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit and descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have testified that this is the Son of God. The first disciples of Jesus. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and he watched Jesus walk by. He exclaimed, look, here is the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, what are you looking for? They said to him, Rabbi, which translated means teacher. Where are you staying? He said to them, come and see. They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of them who had heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, we have found the Messiah, which means anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas, which translated means Peter.
Thanks very much, David. So last week, if you were here last week, you'd have heard me talking about the passage that Val read earlier on, which is about the call of Simon and Andrew, John and James, four disciples in pairs, two sets of brothers, Simon and Andrew, James and John. James and John with their father, who's called Zebedee. And they were fishing, they were getting their nets ready. They were by their boats, which was their business. It was their income. And Jesus came along and he called Simon and Andrew to follow him, and then James and John. And you will remember me saying last week that the fact they left Zebedee in the boat with the hired hands meant they weren't deserting their father in the sense of he no longer had any help. There was still help for him. And I pointed out last week that actually when Jesus called them, he didn't take them very far away, because they went back to their hometown a few times, and we know that they visited Simon Peter's mother-in-law and healed her. So the call to follow Jesus means putting him first. It doesn't necessarily mean going far, far away from your home. So this week, I'm going to talk a little bit about Andrew. And the reason for that is that Simon Peter, later became known as Peter, Simon, James and John, so the two brothers, James and John and Simon, ended up becoming a select threesome that Jesus called to be with him on a few but very significant occasions. One of them was when a little girl, the daughter of a man called Jairus, was at death's door and then died. She was only about 12 years old. And Jairus had sent someone to go and get Jesus to come and heal her. And by the time Jesus got to their house, she had actually died. And what Jesus does, he says to all the people who are weeping, you stay outside of the room where the daughter's body was lying on a bed. And he took with him just those three, James, John, and Simon Peter, and went in with them and prayed for her, and she was raised from the dead. She came to life. Also, when Jesus went on top of a mountain called Mount Tabor, and he had this extraordinary experience where the prophets from of old came and spoke with him, and he had with him Simon, James, and John. So there are times when Jesus occasionally selects three close disciples to be with him. And you sort of think, why does he do that? And I think it's because he wants them, he trusts just a few of them, to see some very significant things that happened, extraordinary signs, if you like, and that they will be able to explain that later on to the others, who will in turn explain it to many others. But Andrew isn't obviously one of those three, even though he was the first person to be called. So we're looking at what John, one of the four gospel writers, says about this first calling of the disciples. I think quite often, if you know that God is stirring you up to do something, you can feel a bit inadequate. I remember years and years ago, I was probably about 23, I had just started a brand new teaching job, and I went to a church that had about 300 people in it, and it had a huge youth group and had a huge young people's children's groups as well. And I really knew, I really felt God was calling me to help run the youth group, and I was too scared. I thought, I'm not good enough. Nobody would want me as a youth leader in this church. So for a year, I just prayed about it and just thought, no, Lord, even though I was teaching some of these kids in a secondary school and was quite used to working with young people who were teenagers, I didn't feel adequate. And quite often we can feel that if God is calling us, we can feel completely inadequate. And we think, am I the right kind of person? Is my faith strong enough? Isaiah was a bit like that when God spoke to him. He felt completely unworthy to be the one that God was calling to share his word. On the other hand, you get people like David when he was writing the Psalms, and he hears the word of the Lord and he says, here I am. I delight to do your will. I'm right here. Send me. Little Samuel, who we talked about last week. Do you remember Samuel and Eli? Once he worked out that it wasn't Eli who was calling him, it was God, he said, here I am, Lord, your servant listens, speak. So we have different reactions to God's calling on that sort of spectrum of thinking, I'm not good enough, to thinking, I'm here, use me. Andrew, in this passage, we see, hears, sees, he believes, and then he follows. You don't follow someone unless you believe in them. Now, I wonder how many of you, like me, have got a Facebook page. Who's got a Facebook page? Yeah. How many of you, like me, are on Twitter? Mum isn't on. Is she not on Twitter? How many of us are on TikTok? One or two. See, my hand doesn't. I actually have joined TikTok, but I haven't got a clue really how to use it, so I haven't really got onto that properly. Instagram, anybody? That crosses the generations a bit, Instagram. Snapchat, is that still a thing now? Is Snapchat still around? Yep. And YouTube. How many of us use YouTube? Yes, lots of us use YouTube. So we know what it means, don't we, to join a platform, a social media platform like that, and follow someone. So on Twitter, I don't really know why I joined it in the first place. I think it was because everybody else had. And then I find some really interesting threads. That means series of comments about issues or about something historical or about something that's current politically. And I will follow that to find out what people are saying. And that leads on to you hear somebody else who makes a comment. You think, that person is really good at understanding. What else have they said? So you go onto their account and you follow them and you find out what they're saying. I'm not sure if TikTok's quite like that, but that is how Twitter tends to function. You follow one after another. And sometimes you follow people on Twitter because they've got thousands of other people following them. Or somebody who's on Twitter making a comment is really impressed when someone like Beyoncé likes them, gives them a like. You know, I had a friend of mine who used to be a vicar, and I forget what it was he posted on Twitter, but he suddenly got a famous person follow him, and he was, oh, look, so-and-so is following me. This is all very exciting. So following is something we're used to, but in terms of social media. You might want to follow a particular influencer. For some people, I doubt it is for our young people, it would be a Kardashian or maybe a royal princess or a musician or a footballer. I don't know if I dare ask Ryan and David if there's somebody famous they follow. Is there anybody famous you follow? Yes? Who do you follow that's very famous? I'm going to come a bit nearer. You're going to have to tell me so I can repeat it. Who's it? KSI. I can't hear that.
KSI? He's on KSI. You follow him, obviously. On YouTube. On YouTube, yeah? KSI. David, is anybody famous you follow? Don't worry, never think about it. But anybody famous that you follow? Not sure. Don't want to admit to it. That's fine. Don't worry. You're welcome to follow me. I'm on Twitter. I don't say much. I normally just make comments at the very most. So,
In our reading today, when we look at Andrew, we don't actually know much about him. We know quite a bit about Simon Peter, but we don't know much about Andrew. Jesus had been, as we saw last week, walking through the Galilee, walking along the lake of Galilee where these guys had been fishing. And he sees these men, and he doesn't check Wikipedia or he doesn't check LinkedIn to check out who these people are. Instead, he just calls them and he knows them. And if you look at the way in which the calling of Simon is described, when Andrew goes to get him and takes him to Jesus, he says to Andrew says to Simon, "We found the Messiah." And he brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. Now, you know, that sounds like a simple reporting of what happened. Jesus looked at him, and these are the words he said. But he looked at him, and the importance about that is that he knew him. I don't know if you've ever had that moment when someone in your life has looked at you, and you suddenly know they know you. And you might be a bit afraid, because there might be something you're ashamed of or worried about. Or you might suddenly think, oh my goodness, somebody who understands me. That's so important, isn't it, in our lives, that we have somebody who understands us. Jesus looked at him and he knew him. And he knew him so well, he told him what that transformation was going to be like, the changing of the water that we saw by that little drop of colour, or the change that a rock can make when you drop it in water. The colour actually transforms it. And this drop of Jesus' life coming into Simon's life was going to change him. And the reason why John records it is that the name Cephas, which was also Peter, actually means the rock. And later on, John says, on this rock, Jesus says, on this rock I will build my church. So Jesus can already see your potential. He can already see how you're going to be transformed. He's really delighted by it. And all you have to do is follow. So the invitation that Andrew gives to his brother is, come and see, come and see. Jesus has already said to Andrew, come and see. He invites Jesus to come and see before they have to say anything. He invites them to follow him and work with him, minister, serve with him, before they have to say anything. And then as they follow him and they're with him, they are then able to proclaim the news. They understand it. They've lived it. And when Andrew understood that, that was what motivated him to then go and get Simon, and for Simon to meet Jesus and know that Jesus knew him and that was going to change his life. He was going to become a rock. Andrew knew that if he brought his brother into the presence of Jesus, his brother could be transformed in the way that Andrew had just experienced transformation. That he would be transformed to follow the way that leads to justice, the way that leads to peace in the world. For every person who's like Peter, James, and John, the ones who are named and come to the forefront of ministry later on in Jesus' life, the ones who from time to time are drawn out to be closer to Jesus, to see the most extraordinary signs and wonders. For every person who's like that, there are hundreds and thousands of Andrews who've already said, come and see, come and see. I have got friends on Facebook and so on, who I used to teach many years ago. One of them is a bishop now, so I am in submission to that bishop. I'm sure others of you who are old enough to have influenced young people, you find some will grow in order to be in positions of authority over you. But in this case, It's Andrew's brother who's going to be, Simon Peter, who's going to be in authority over Andrew. And it was Andrew who drew him to Jesus in the first place. All of us are called just to follow as Andrew did, to follow, to see, to allow Jesus to change us, and then to bring those closest to us to see him as well. I'm just going to ask Regina if she'd come and join us up here, and just to tell us, you tell us a story of how Jesus called you, because you've lived as long as I have, and people have heard me talk frequently. So would you like just to share how Jesus has called you?
Morning, everyone. Morning. Yeah. So, yeah, I think I've mentioned to some of you before that as I was growing up, my grandmother played a big influence in my faith. Her love for the Lord was so evident, and it shone even in the most difficult times. We could hear her singing her way through some of those difficulties. And we looked forward each night to time with her, with Bible study and prayer before bed. Then I went to a secondary mission around a boarding school where I continued to grow in my faith under the guidance and influence of some missionaries from New Zealand there. I remember then in my late teens, in times when we would go with some missionaries on the streets, witnessing for Christ, and at that age, seeing some of the things, it was quite hair-raising. But they were exciting times. We looked forward to those times to go on the streets. Now, time went on, and there were times, obviously, of doubt, of challenges, of difficulties, like any of us here do. But in spite of them all, God continued to guide my life. In 1998, we moved to Shirley from Upper Norwood, and I was looking for a church where I felt that I would it would be a spiritual home. I tried quite a few different churches, and my family aghast at me moving from one church to another. But I was really spiritually restless, and something in me was just stirring to go and discover more. I remember at one time I started leading a prayer morning sessions at Hall Grange, which is up near Trinity roundabout. And it was a time really where I felt really encouraged, and I felt I was growing in my faith. I had the opportunity to share my faith with the elderly people there every Wednesday morning. And it was quite a lovely time. I did like elderly people, because I think because my grandmother was, well, I was quite close to her. So I found I had this affinity for the elderly, and with some great times sharing faith and singing and Bible study. In 2003, my husband knew I was restless and looking for a church, and he also wasn't settled where we were. He wanted the boys to be Anglican, baptized in Anglican church. So anyway, he was going to IKEA one Sunday, and he passed through here, and he said he could smell some barbecue meat. So he thought he would go and discover where it was coming from. So he went to the back and found a whole lot of people. When he came to report to me, he said there were very lovely people there, and I think he said you should try that church next Sunday. So anyway, I came the following Sunday, and I remember kneeling in that pew where I was sitting just now, that very first visit, and the sense of God's presence was so evident, and I just sensed that it was right that we should be here. And as time moved on, and under the guidance of Reverend Richard Williams, whom I think some of you will know, he encouraged me to explore a reader ministry. And then I went for interviews and Trinity House and on those vocational study days. And that's from then I started leading evening prayers here. And I joined Reader Ministry, a training But I didn't understand how God could do that, because what here was a mother, you know, young family, and I was also just started the business, the pharmacy, and I was also starting pharmacy training. And how could he possibly call me to go and do reader training at the same time as have this other course which I was, you know, studying, traveling all the way to Medway, and Thursday coming to, you know, Southwark from Medway to do reader training. But yeah, God has ways. When he's called, you think, how is it possible that this can happen? And some people called me, they thought really I had lost it a bit, because how could it be that a mature student tackles two courses, demanding courses at the same time? But it wasn't me. I knew very well, I had this strong sense that it was God, and that if he had called me to do that, he would give me the strength. And sure enough, he did. And here I am, and I hope that I have been an encouragement to other people in a small way as a reader. God, when he calls you, he does indeed strengthen you, gives you the grace to do that which he calls you to do, no matter the challenges. Thank you.
Thank you, Regina. It's really, really good when you've got somebody my our age to be able to look back over your life and just see the pattern of how God has been calling us right from childhood, right within our families and within our schools as well. And some of you will be experiencing that, and some of us here will be going through quite a tough time right now for one reason or another. And it's quite hard to believe if God's really interested or he really knows what's going on. But just remember that when Simon Peter first came to Jesus, Jesus just looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John." He knows exactly who you are. I always find that passage very meaningful for me, because my surname means son of John. And if I had been a boy, apparently I would have been called Simon. So it's not often that Jesus calls him Simon, son of John. Later on, he calls him Peter more frequently. But it brings me up short when I hear what my name might have been like being used by the word, in the words of Jesus that are written down. But he knows all of your names right now. Simon, son of John, follow me. Let's just, in a moment of quiet, we're actually going to say something in this moment of quiet, but we're going to say it to ourselves. Just take your first name and your surname. In my case, it's Amanda Johnson. Amanda Johnson, follow me. We're just going to say that very quietly to ourselves, and then we're going to ask Jesus to show us how to follow him through the times that we're facing just now. So let's just be quiet for a moment, and then as I say the words using my name, you do the same with your name. The Lord Jesus says, "Amanda Johnson, follow me." Let's imagine we just turn our eyes to look to Jesus. We reach out our hand to put our hand into his hand. And we say, "Yes, I will follow you." As we continue to listen to what the Lord is saying, we're going to sing two songs together now, "Draw Me Close to You" and "Jesus, Lover of My Soul." And during this time, if you just want to come forward for a short prayer for blessing, I'm sure Regina will come and help. We will be just standing here to say a prayer for you. If you want to come up, whether you're young or whether you're old, as we sing these two songs. But let's stand together to sing "Draw Me Close to You" and "Jesus, Lover of My Soul."
Draw me close. to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way. Bring me back to you.
Lord Jesus, thank you that you have come to bless us, to lead us. Thank you that you know us. You might like to sit as we just continue in prayer for a few moments. And Father, we pray for our world, for the friction and discord there is in our world. We pray for your peace, for your light to come. We pray especially for the conflict between Russia and Ukraine. We pray for the people who are so devastated by what has happened. We pray, Lord, for your healing and for your peace. We pray for a halt to all the hostility that Russia has heaped on Ukraine. We pray for those, Lord, who come to our country as refugees and asylum seekers to find your peace and to find haven. We pray for all those who, for no good reason at all, find themselves homeless and without a place where their children may flourish. Father, we pray for a change in policy. We pray for a change in local attitudes. We pray, Lord, for there to be peace and hospitality offered to all those who are in need. We pray for our church family here, for those we know and those we don't know, that you would help us each one to grow in love for you. We pray for our brothers and sisters here who face a time of difficulty. We pray for your strength and for friendship to flourish. And we thank you, Lord, for the lives of those we have loved, but who have died and gone ahead of us to be with you. We thank you for them this morning, Lord, and we ask you to fill the gap, the space, the almost the chasm that their departing has left. We pray for your restoration in our lives. Thank you, Lord, that you are here with us and that nothing is impossible with you. Amen. Just as we come to share communion, shall we just stand together to share the peace with one another? When Jesus came and stood amongst his disciples, he said to them, "Peace be with you. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you." We share a sign of that peace with one another. Isabella. So when we receive communion, and we're just going to form a semicircle where the white and the grey flooring meets each other. It forms a nice line to show us where to stand. Put the words on the screen. I'm going to have to use the words from the screen. I haven't got the words here today. So the Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you. For yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son, for your children, and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat,
This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven, saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come, who was and is to come. We like to sit or kneel. We're going to pray this prayer together. We pray together. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through by his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. And we say together, as Jesus our Saviour taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. So come to this table, you who have much faith, and you who would like to have more, you who have been here often, and you who have not been for a long time, you who have tried to follow Jesus, and you who have failed, come. It is Christ who invites us to meet him here. Amen. I can invite Regina to come up. Isabella, could you pass some of the gel? Thank you. Just to come and form a semicircle around. If you wish not to receive bread and wine today, please just keep your hands by your side. Thank you. Thank you. Let's just say a prayer of thanksgiving. Lord Jesus, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We offer you our lives as a sacrifice to your praise and your glory. Will you fill us with your Holy Spirit that we may shine for you in Jesus' name? Amen. In a minute, we're going to sing our last song. Now, we have put some hot water on. It'd be quite helpful to have one or two people who could just volunteer to serve the tea and coffee from the back today. But the hot water's there for the tea and the coffee's there, and we'll fetch some milk in just a minute. So just hang around for a little bit longer if you'd like to after the service. It would be lovely to have a time to chat together. If you're around, I think most of us are working, but if you're around on Thursday, Cafe Matinee this week is showing the importance of being earnest. I think that would be a great title for a sermon, but it's also a very good title for a very funny old comedic film. That's on this Thursday afternoon. Next Sunday, 10:30 here, kind of a lion, and it's a shared service together. So do come along next Sunday, and we're going to be having soup and bread afterwards. So you either have that as your frugal lunch next Sunday, or it becomes your first course before you go home for the rest of it. So that's next Sunday at 10:30. And then we've got the Jonathan Vieira concert coming up only in 3 weeks' time. Can we just see the video for that, please, Quaker?
So, you've got this guy, Jonathan Vieira, coming to your church very soon. What a fantastic opportunity to bring your friends and family along to something that is a unique experience. This is something that is suitable for all ages, from 9 to 99, and every single person from every single background really enjoys coming to a Jonathan Vieira evening. Now, I know that many of you will be sitting there thinking, who is Jonathan Vieira? I've never heard of him. So let me tell you, he is an internationally acclaimed, world-class singer, beautiful voice, but so much more. He is a naturally funny, laugh-out-loud man who just tells the most brilliant stories and has people rolling on the floor with laughter. So if you like, he's a singing comedian or a comic singer.
What an amazing evening. I've been waiting so long for it anyway. It was like 10 concerts in one night.
He just brings the place alive, and it's just fantastic. I'd recommend it. If you get the chance to see him anywhere, you've got to go.
So, what can you expect when you come along to this Jonathan Vieira evening? There will be music, masses of music, everything from big ballads to a bit of boogie-woogie, maybe a bit of classical, and everything in between. There will be masses of laughter, lots of funny stories. There will also be Jonathan just engaging with the audience. He is a naturally warm, engaging man. He just loves people. That comes across. And because he's a Christian, he shares that faith in a very natural, very honest way that is acceptable to everyone. So who am I and why am I telling you all this? Well, my name is Sue, and I've been married to Jonathan for longer than 30 years. And am I biased? Just a tad. But then I've watched him perform to thousands of people, and I've seen how much people enjoy it. I've spoken to hundreds of people after the shows where we've travelled all around the country, and I know how inspired and uplifted people are. So I want you to grab this opportunity, think about getting those tickets, think about who you can bring with you, and just take this opportunity while you can to see Jonathan Vieira in action.
He's coming here on Saturday the 11th of February. So get tickets if you can. Invite friends and family to come. You'll have a really fun and lovely evening here. That's Jonathan Vieira coming here to do a concert on the 11th of February. We are saying goodbye to our amazing preschool manager, Sarah, who has been with us for many years, but actually has been the manager of the school for the last 5 years and managed it through the awful and difficult times for preschools during lockdown, the three different lockdowns and in between. And has I've worked quite closely with her. I've seen her cope with very difficult situations besides the lockdown ones. So we're very sorry to leave her, and the PCC agreed to give her a gift from the church centrally, which we will do on Friday when we say goodbye to her, with a card. So the card for Sarah is actually over on
It's on one of the two tables there. I think it's over there on the giving table. If you could just sign it before you go, you may not have met her, but having names rather than just love from St. Mary's, I think, makes a difference to somebody and enables her to appreciate our appreciation. And Alicia will be taking up the reins as of next Monday, so do be praying for Alicia. She becomes our manager, having been the deputy manager until now. She has done a great job, and we're really pleased that she is taking on that role as well. Now, at the back, just where Isabel is standing, is a almost blank piece of paper. And we're just, Val and I, are just finding out which of you might be willing to do a reading. I quite often jump on Ryan or David to come and do a reading, but others of you might like to do a reading during a service, or even might be willing to lead two or three prayers during the service. So if you could just sign it, Isabella's now holding it up. If you'd like to just put your name on there and whether or not you'd be willing to do a reading from time to time or to lead some prayers from time to time, that would help the service to be led by more people than just the three or four of us who are currently on those lists. So we come to sing our last song and we receive our offerings during this song. Let's stand and sing Light of the World. So the blessing, and then we're going to have coffee and tea together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for being here with us and that you are with us as we go from this place too. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he lift up his face to shine upon you. May he lift up his face and be gracious to you and grant you his peace. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.